Let us discuss about pharmacological actions of anticholinergic drugs. Okay, pharmacological actions of anticholinergic drugs. In this, we'll use atropine as prototype. Okay, we'll use atropine as prototype, and this will be applied to all the other drugs. Prototype. You see, we discussed about the classification in the last lecture. Okay, in this lecture, we'll mainly focus on actions, adverse effect, and uses. Okay. Now we'll discuss about the pharmacological action. You see, this atropine, it blocks all the muscarinic receptors. Coming to action on CNS, the overall action is stimulatory. Okay, it has got stimulant reaction on CNS, and it has got the permeability through blood-brain barrier is not good. Okay, it cannot cross blood-brain barriers to a such a good level. Okay, permeability is not good. Hence, if you give low doses, we will see only peripheral action. If you want the CNS actions, then we have to give high doses. What it does is, it stimulates some medullary centers. Okay, it stimulates medullary centers. They include, they stimulate vagal center, respiratory center. They stimulate vasomotor center as well. Okay, atropine stimulates vagal center, respiratory center, and vasomotor center. It has got anticholinergic action, right? Hence, it can depress vestibular excitation, because in vestibular excitation there is involvement of anticholinergic action. Okay, there it can depress vestibular excitation, because in vestibular excitation there is involvement of cholinergic action. Hence, as the atropine is inhibiting this cholinergic action, it can depress vestibular excitation. Thereby, we can use this action in anti-motion sickness. And also, this atropine, it decreases the cholinergic activity in basal ganglia. It decreases the overactivity of cholinergic system in basal ganglia. Due to decrease in the cholinergic system, there is decrease in the rigidity. There is decrease in the rigidity, and it also suppresses tremors. This property is useful in Parkinsonism patients. In Parkinsonism patients, if we give atropine, there is decrease in rigidity as well as there is suppression of tremors. And if we give still high doses, then there will be cortical excitation, there will be restlessness, disorientation, hallucination, delirium, and this is followed by depression of respiratory center and coma. All these things takes place in overdose. They are cortical excitation, restlessness, disorientation, hallucination, delirium, depression of respiratory syndrome. This followed by coma. Coming to action on CVS, that means cardiovascular system. You see, the action of cholinergic system on heart is they decreases heart rate. Yes, yes or no? They decrease heart rate, right? So we are using anticholinergic right now. So what anticholinergic do is they increase heart rate. They increase heart rate. So the action of atropine heart on heart will be increasing heart rate. Increasing heart rate. But initially, if you give the drug, initially there will be bradycardia. There will be bradycardia initially. The reason is, you see, as all of us know, what is auto receptor, right? This is presynaptic membrane, this is postsynaptic. So there is auto receptor, that is M1. This is auto receptor. Initially, what happens is there is inhibition of this auto receptor. This results in increase in the release of acetylcholine. Due to inhibition of this M1 receptor, which is an auto receptor, there is increase in acetylcholine, which is responsible for bradycardia. Bradycardia. Okay. The reason for initial bradycardia is blockage of M1 receptor, which is an auto receptor. After some time, then M2 receptor will be blocked. Okay. After some time, M2 receptor will be blocked, which is an postsynaptic membrane. Which is a postsynaptic membrane, which results in tachycardia. Tachycardia. See here, the inhibition is mainly by inhibiting the action of vagus nerve. We should remember this. Okay. Here the mechanism is usually. We have SA node. SA node is innervated by vagus nerve. So whenever vagus nerve is stimulated, it releases acetylcholine. Okay, this acetylcholine will stimulate SA node. Will depress SA node. Then due to depression of SA node, bradycardia will take place. Okay, this is usual mechanism. So we are inhibiting this acetylcholine receptors on SA node, right? So the action of vagus nerve will be inhibited, thereby causing tachycardia instead of bradycardia. Okay, this is mechanism. So the mechanism is inhibition of the effect of vagus nerve, which ultimately results in tachycardia. Okay, and this is one mechanism. And one more action is there is increase in AV nodal conduction. Okay, there is increase in AV conduction, especially if it has been depressed by some vagal tone. Okay, if this AV node conduction is decreased by vagus nerve, then that inhibition will be overcome by usage of atropine. Remember this. So there is increase in the conduction of AV node. Hence we can use this atropine in partial AV nodal conduction. If there is any partial AV nodal conduction, if there is any partial block of AV nodal conduction, in such cases we can use this atropine. Okay, if there is any partial AV block, then we can use atropine, especially when the conduction block is due to vagus nerve. Okay, then there is shortening of PR interval. PR interval will be shortened. Okay, and effect on BP. If take effect on BP, you see, BP will be increased by stimulation of vasomotor center and by increasing heart rate. Through these two actions, by increasing the heart rate, by increasing the by stimulation of vasomotor center, there is increase in BP. But by there is decrease in BP due to release of histamine. Okay, there is release of histamine which causes vasodilation, which ultimately result in decrease in blood pressure. And one more is there is direct vasodilatory action when it is given at high doses. Okay, when it at high doses, this atropine, it has got vasodilatory action. Okay, with the help of these two actions, increased release of histamine and due to vasodilatory action at high doses, these two things will cause decrease in BP. Okay, it has got two action. One is increase in BP. One is it can increase the BP. Other is it can decrease the BP. I told you the mechanism behind these two actions. And then they move into action on eye. Action on eye. If you give the drug, if you give the drug topically, then there is mydriasis. There is also ablation of light reflex will not work out. Okay, there is ablation of light reflex. And another one is there is cycloplasia. What is cycloplasia? Cycloplasia means loss of accommodation. Okay, loss of accommodation is called cycloplasia. And there is also photophobia. There is also blurring of vision. There is also increase in intraocular tension. All these things will take place. Okay, one is it causes mydriasis. There is ablation of light reflex. There is cycloplasia, photophobia, blurring of vision, rising intraocular tension. All these things will take place on eye. This is about the action on eye. Then move into action on smooth muscles. If take action on smooth muscles will be relaxed. Okay, those muscles which are innervated by parasympathetic system, these muscles will be relaxed. Okay, smooth muscles will be relaxed. Okay, this results in, this is mainly by blockage of M3 receptor. Okay, remember this. So this, due to relaxation of smooth muscles, there is decrease in tone as well as amplitude of contraction of stomach and intestine. Okay, there is decrease in tone as well as decrease in the amplitude of contractions of stomach and intestine. Stomach and intestine. As there is decrease in contraction in the stomach, the movement of bile will be, okay, the movement of stomach contents will be decreased. Okay, the passage of chyme is slowed down. And due to inhibition of the movements of contractions in the stomach, it results in constipation. But one important clinical application here is it can relieve spasm. Okay, if the spasm is due to smooth muscle contraction, then it can relieve spasm. Remember this. And one more thing is that there is enhanced motility due to injected cholinergic drug is more completely antagonized. Okay, if the increased motility or increased smooth muscle contraction is due to some cholinergic drugs, then such type of cholinergic motility will be decreased. Remember this. If the contraction is due to some cholinergic drugs, then such contraction will be relieved more easily. Okay. And atropine also causes bronchodilation, because there is decrease in contraction of smooth muscles, hence it can also called bronchodilation. Okay, this can be seen especially in COPD, useful especially in COPDs and asthma patients. Okay, this can be useful especially in COPD patients, asthma patients. Okay, atropine also causes also as gut laxant action, ureter and as well as urinary bladder. Okay, it has also got relaxant effect on urinary bladder as well as ureter. Okay, as there is relaxant effect on urinary bladder, this results in retention of urine. This will be very problematic in patients who have prostatic hypertrophy. Okay, if the people is suffering from prostatic hypertrophy, in such patient this urinary retention will be problematic. And the benefit is that there is increasing capacity, right? So there is increasing due to this relaxation, increase in the capacity of bladder will take place. This property can be useful in treating neurogenic bladder. Okay, can be useful in treating neurogenic bladder. Okay, and even the relaxation of bile tract is less marked. Okay, effect on bile tract is less, remember this, is less. Then moving to the effect on glands, this atropine, it decreases the secretions, especially sweat glands, salivary glands, tracheobronchial secretions. Okay, it decreases tracheobronchial secretion as well as lacrimal secretions. Okay, as there is decrease in lacrimal secretion, it results in dry eyes. As there is decrease in secretion of sweat glands, this results in dry skin. As there is decrease in the secretion of salivary glands, it results in dry mouth. As there is decrease in the tracheobronchial secretion, it results in difficulty in speaking. Okay, both salivary gland, decrease in spit and tracheobronchial secretion, all these things results in difficulty in speaking. Okay, atropine also decreases the secretion of acid and pepsin. It also decreases the secretion of acid and pepsin in the stomach. Okay, the effect is mainly on volume. The amount of acid and pepsin secreted will be decreased, so the pH will not be altered. Okay, and this is about the action on glands. Then moving to effect on body temperature. This will be affected at high doses. Okay, temperature will be affected at high doses, and there is increase in the body temperature, and this is mainly due to two things. One is there is decrease in sweating, right? And one more is there is stimulation of temperature regulatory center. Okay, temperature regulating centers. Temperature regulating center. Okay, this is the action on body temperature. This increase in body temperature is especially seen in case of children. Okay, they are more prone for increasing body temperature, this children. Okay, then moving to effect on local anesthetic. Effect on local anesthetic. You see, this atropine can act as mild anesthetic action on cornea. Okay, it has got mild anesthetic action on cornea. On cornea, it has got mild anesthetic action. This is about the actions. Then we'll discuss the remaining things in the next video. Okay, thank you for watching.